want to really spend a little bit of time about brand. So when I asked the different panelists to come on board, one of the panelists sent me something which is kind of provocative about how you define brand, its positioning, its attributes, its relationships. And basically it says, it's not what you say it is, it's what they say it is, which is interesting. Today's best brands thrive because they are agile. Brands must embrace this agility paradox by mastering two contradictory strategies, honoring core tenets while simultaneously evolving to stay fresh and relevant. And agile means creating a holistic experience, feel, look, feel, talk, do, dream, and feel. So I'll start with Teresa, then we'll go down the line. How would you define Cayman's tourism brand? And do you think we fit some of the definition that I've just kind of explained?
Absolutely, I think that's where we are succeeding because we do have a genuine feel. We make people feel that they want to be and they want to be here. Now, as this market matures, our target segment transcends the student experiences and want and transformational experiences. That's where our opportunity to elevate the caliber of our service lies.
Mark?
I would probably characterize it as a sense of well-being, and a very true sense of well-being, which is very genuine. It's not artificial. I think people feel very comfortable. I think we have an opportunity here in a niche market, kind of a luxury we find, where people feel very comfortable to come here. It's not necessarily flashy, but it's natural. I think that the genuine care, the human kind, all that coming too, but also it's about the sense of that destination that is very well refined, but just, you know,
welcome. I definitely agree with my
colleagues.
I'd add to it that authenticity is really important, and you mentioned innovation and agility. That's something that we absolutely know that people who know Cayman expect from us, and it's something that we also do as a core belief. A lot of what people are moving towards is goodness-based living. So we talk a lot about lifestyle branding and positioning this destination for people who are very interested in the personal well-being and transformation themselves. And this brand offers that because, again, to the point that those who live here also want those that quality of lifestyle. So it's an authentic brand. We stay innovative, but we're also true to what the market's looking for.
Thank you for having me. Yes, I agree with three previous panelists, and I particularly want to pick up on that point of authenticity. I think part of what makes our brand so strong and resonate with people who know it is that we are not promising something that we don't deliver. So we talk about, Cayman Kind actually was less about being nice and more about the way Cayman does things. It was intended to be about the manner in which Cayman does things, and it was about leadership. It was about innovation, it was about quality. And I certainly appreciated when Teresa talked about the natural and the built environment, because I think you certainly see it in the built environment. You see it in our care and protection of the natural environment. Where I think this brand has an opportunity is to consistently deliver on the service experience and the social experience. But I agree, we're a lifestyle brand. We are reflecting the country brand, and in many ways, there's an opportunity for us to work with financial services to get the country brand to be as strong and positive as the tourism brand.
Some people believe that because we have the two pillars of our tourism industry, the cruise visitor and the overnight visitor, that there's really a diametrically opposed brand conflict. Well, our national hero, Jim Bodden, years ago used to call cruise ship passengers the peanut butter and jelly tourists, where they actually brought everything on shore with them, including the sandwiches and things that they have. Now, I know that over the years there have been conversion efforts to turn those passengers over to long-night visitors, and many of them have come. But what do you think about, and ask everyone on the panel, about the conflict between the ever-increasing number of cruise ship passengers and then also the increasing number of overnight visitors and the kind of attention for the brand as to where we really position ourselves in trying to attract people?
Happy to start with that one. I think that there isn't a conflict between crews and scalability. There's a conflict between the experience management. We need to focus on the cruise visitor who reflects the stayover visitor's demographic profile. And if we have not yet architected and designed and been able to assure ourselves that we can handle millions of cruise visitors and ensure that they have the same brand experience we want them to have as our stayover guest experiences, then we have to just pause and calibrate the cruise tourism numbers to make sure that whether you're a cruise stayover guest or you're a cruise guest or a stayover guest, that you have the same experience. In a past life, when I represented the Cayman Islands and did marketing, the worst thing that could happen would be to have someone, Upper East Side, New York, who would come to Cayman by air, sit in a coffee shop and talk to someone who would come to Cayman by cruise, and they had completely different stories just by virtue of the experience. They came at the same time, they could have been here in the same week, but they had different experience. So I think our responsibility, our brand responsibility, is more about making sure that each one has a good experience. And if we are attracting people who are lower household income, who are traveling by cruise because it's not just affordable, but it's at a price point that typically you won't be able to access to that in February, then they're not going to have a good experience because the cost of a meal, the cost of transportation is what it is. So the calibration also has to be around who is purchasing that cruise and can they enjoy Cayman without feeling like they got poor value.
Yeah, we strongly feel that some of this through experience management side. The NTP does talk about how we'll manage cruise visitors and we'll have a lot built into overall visitor management, both stayover and cruise. One of the things that we find encouraging, just from our statistics, we continue to collect on both type of visitor, stayover and cruise, is that the intention to visit is strong on both sides. We have over 50% of both cruise and stayover visitors who intend to come back to destination, as well as for a long time, there were definitely services and experiences that the cruise visitor was not having a good, not similar experience to stayover. We see those things changing. So we strongly feel that if there's strong visitor management, there's strong planning to ensure that stayover and cruise can be managed effectively in our destination, that both visitors are important to our economy. One of the things we also are very supportive of cruise up is that as a destination, we're still quite small. There's still a lot of people out there spending lots more money than we do in the market, regardless of what Mr. Jude said. And what's important about cruise is there are many of them, and they raise the awareness of this destination. And oftentimes, more than likely, always, they have a positive message to say about the destination. So even though they may have come with cruise, they're influencing others to try our destination from a positive perspective.
So then you can confirm it. When I talk about customers, many of them have discovered the island quite often from a cruise ship and actually do it like the window shopping.
Yeah.
Come back here, Also, as Ritz Carlton, we talk about innovation. I'm sure you're aware of the news that we have a new collection called the Yacht Collection. Mm-hmm. And right now, we're working on trying to figure out that who will be the destination they will choose first to come here. So it's going to be exceptional. So it's funny, I was looking at your slide earlier, and there were three words, which was excellence, innovation, and balance. And I think that's, again, that's going to reflect how can we deal with that combination. Balancing the two is if that port is suddenly become a gate to let more flow coming here, that's not going to work. But if it is for a better experience and creating innovation and turning excellence, then that's a winner. It cannot be suddenly let's open a gate to go and there's thousands of people coming per day, and that's not going to be working. So it's about that balance.
I would just add that not totally in concern about the experience the cruise passenger has, which it's important. But the other side of this is ensuring that their presence is not distracting and detracting from the experience of our stayover guests. And that goes back to the management of visitor experiences and the facilities, regulation, enforcement, those kind of things.
Well, Cayman has a wonderful position that both our financial industry and tourism, it seems to be on the upward, economic growth spiral, which is great. The question then is about, and some of our counselors asked me to kind of put put some questions forward, about the caring capacity of the expectation of all these people coming. And, you know, between the cruise and the overnight visitor during the high season, how do you think we, as a brand, have to manage that expectation in a much different way? And what can we do? We talked a little bit about infrastructure. And we talked a little bit, I looked at the national tourism plan that's going to be unveiled. They also talk about these concerns and the caring capacity and how it affects your brand. Because it takes 10 people to have a terrible experience somewhere, and they tell 10 others, and you know the story. So the question for all of you is, when does the caring capacity for a small island community come into conflict with its brand?
Again, I think that there are days in our typical high season when we're there. You know, there are certainly days when we don't have sufficient carrying capacity in terms of road infrastructure or beach access or locations and tours. So we're there. I think there are certain days in February and March where there's probably conflict on our beaches. There's probably conflict downtown Georgetown in terms of retail because the physical space cannot handle both. And cruise essentially creates a tidal wave of visitors that come on at a particular time, and then that wave retreats. And when they're on shore, that's when the challenge is. I also think, though, that that's where the opportunity is, because Nisha, you might know if this has changed, but I certainly remember that one of the things we have not done was to diversify the amount of experiences and tours that were available for cruise. So if you could just imagine a sort of a bar chart with, you know, the horizontal axis being the number of different activities that cruise visitors could do, Cayman, unlike other Caribbean islands, everything was concentrated to the far left around a Stingray City or a Turtle Farm or a Turtle Center or, you know, going to the beach. We did not have enough diversity of tours to spread those visitors. So everyone was really on this north-south peninsula, and everyone was on the beach or going to the north sound, which, since this is where most of the land-based tourism development is as well, is creating the conflict. I do think we need to manage numbers. I don't want to shy away from that. I don't know that this, I certainly haven't done the modeling, but I don't know that this country can carry 2+ million cruise visitors because they don't come evenly across the year. Having said that, to the extent that we invite cruise visitors to our country, we have a responsibility to make sure that they have a good experience. We also have a responsibility to make sure that the hotel brands and the developers of hotels on Seven Mile Beach are not having to struggle to deliver a guest experience because as a country we created conflict. Right? We have a responsibility to both sets of investors and both sets of visitors.
I absolutely agree with what Clara is saying, but we also see that there are efforts to develop in what we would say 90% of our tourism profit is in the Seven Mile Beach corridor. We have a large opportunity to develop on the other side of that. And one of the things we know this was looking for is diversified experiences. Some of our attractions have been much better than others to be able to do that. And we continue to encourage those types of attractions. So we know that Pedro St. James is having lots of new interactive programming, and they're marrying that with the Seven Mile Beach typical type of excursions, because then that gets them the ability to try both things. The Crystal Caves have been very successful on their entry. It's now one of the top things for our cruise passengers to do as well, and that's taking them off the corridor. Additionally, we see development and real estate also going to that side from a tourism development perspective. We're encouraging that. Part of what the NTP will do in our National Tourism Plan is it talks about investing in small entrepreneurs who want to grow in tourism. And we're specifically looking for entrepreneurs who want to do things in tourism that are outside of typical in terms of outside the Seven Mile Beach corridor, outside of pure water sports. So again, this idea of managing visitors, giving guests new things to do, as well as taking some of the pressure off what we know is centralized to the Seven Mile Beach area. To answer your question, we don't know what the carrying capacity is yet of our destination. It is a part of what will be studied as a part of NTP. To say we need to develop the model as to what will be the number. I can't sit here today and say that we do know that number.
Okay, just one final question before opening up and up to the audience. And it relates to the economy generally and financial services. We've heard a little bit about the challenges of financial services has, which is interesting. On one hand, they have a situation where the media thinks Cayman is doing all these bad things, on one hand. But the business itself understands what Cayman does, and they do business with us. And then on the other hand, we have tourism, where we're promoting We're Cayman Kind. Now, I can guarantee you that there are some people that visit us that believe in Cayman Kind and have a hedge fund. So the question I have for our brand is, could there be collaboration between financial services, truly, and tourism to make both Cayman Kind?
Absolutely. I think that was the unfinished business of branding the tourism industry. So, you know, Mr. Scott here in the front row, that was exactly what we hoped would happen. Certainly not long after we did that work, we went into a recession, but I think that we're ready. And I would invite the real estate sector to the table as well, and the health sector to the table. So I think one of our brand attributes is innovation. I mean, when we did the work, innovation came out. Quality and leadership came out. So I think that the time is right for us to take the core of the Cayman brand from tourism and from financial services and work through that to a country brand. Well, we should be, we should be leveraging all of those people who have connected with Cayman for business reasons and get them to be these loyal ambassadors for us as well, because we sort of keep them separate. It's their little secret. But they could definitely help change the image and reputation of the country if they would be more open, and we help them be more open to talk about how great we are.
Both of those interests share the same attributes. So, you know, all the attributes that Mr. Scott about, you know, strength, agility, governance, all those things are the same attributes we have in tourism. So it absolutely makes sense for us to join together to do that. We also know that internationally, we oftentimes get hit with the negative perception on the tourism side because of, you know, the noise that's in the financial sector in terms of what's happening. So we feel that messaging together is important. We've talked about that before. Our team, we always try to ensure we have key messages for finance, regardless of where we are, because we're one brand in market. So I think there's opportunity for us to do that, and we look forward to being.
Well, maybe there'd be a collaboration. I was in London and I kind of asked the Loops a few questions just for the team with the Cayman office in London, just trying to get an understanding of how much they really knew about financial services and tourism. It's a fascinating, interesting issue, I think. And that question I would say to you, Anisha, is whether there needs to be training on the ground by the DOT overseas about even our financial industry, how it works so that they can counteract some of those questions that they may see. So I'd like to open up now for questions for the audience. Excellent, this is Mr. Adam. Okay. Ross, can you get the mic to him, please? And I, with the cruise question wasn't intended, it was a tongue in cheek. I know how important the cruise industry really is for Cayman. It's just the carrying capacity. Oh, there it is. Oh, I'm sorry, I should have asked Paul. You were hiding me.
Thank you very much for the panelists, great presentations, and Will, you just provided a perfect segue to something that we absolutely need to follow up on. I don't know if this is a different angle, but exactly what you said is the foundation of something we work on. Jill gave a world-class presentation. He mentioned some of the amazing factors, features, and percentages within financial services. This one he didn't mention, that features and what we can do with these two industries together. I think tourism and American financial services. Here's this. To be frank with you, tourism began before financial services began in Cayman. But yet, somehow, the financial services industry come to mind. This should develop. Where when I look at the Labor Force survey for fall 2017, right, the figure for the percentage of workmen in financial and insurance activities, the number of workmen is 14.2%. When I compare that with accommodation, 38.5% workmen, restaurants and mobile food services, 65.1%. And they say, there's a lot of financial services industry can help us with, figure out how is it that they have built this amazingly world class. I mean, depending on who you talk, as whether you're number five, number seven, number three, no question is world class. We saw one of the examples of that. Jude Scott came in and delivered a world class presentation. There is much that can be learned from financial services into the very thing we're sort of talking about, the social environment. Because when we have over 1,500 Canadians that are unemployed, most of the people had jobs at one time, right? And we want to talk, the theme of this was sustainability. It is not sustainable to have those percentages in the food service restaurant industry. And even in the accommodation industry, year after year after year, still in working minutes. We can learn, and the financial services industry can help us tremendously. Let's learn from each other. Leverage that tremendous success.
Thank you, Mr. Tim. I mean, the reality is we have a network. I think President Paul, at the beginning in his comments, at the chamber presentation, talked a little bit about Team Cayman. And it's fascinating how Team Cayman can be divided into so many bits and pieces sometimes to suit certain agendas. Reality is $20 million in one budget, $5 million in one budget, we're all on the same team, right? We're all trying to develop the economy together, right? And then I just tossed, any other questions from the audience? Excellent, good. Another question now? Natalie?
Yeah, I understand that the within the cruise industry, the different lines take to different markets. So you have some markets that cater to maybe the party goers and some to the more affluent and some to the retirees. Is there a way to structure the visitation of those cruise liners so that maybe the more affluent persons or those that could be more proud on those lines can come on certain days, maybe they come on Monday and only two of those ships, so they have that luxury experience as opposed to others that may have, you know, seven ships, you know, coming in on a day and, you know, while at the same time trying to still give everyone that balance where you have a good experience, whatever it is,
so maybe. And you probably want that one, right?
I think that. Truthfully, the lines don't necessarily structure their clients that way. So within each line, each brand, they will have varying levels of customers. So they have cabins, you know, all the way from top category, you know, varying price points throughout. So it wouldn't be necessarily an opportunity to schedule specifically what lines will come each day. One of the things we have looked at is lines that we target specifically for perhaps smaller islands like the Sister Islands, or lines that we target for a premium customer like Disney Cruise Line. And one of the things that we will do with a line like Disney is give them specific experiences and specific care. Again, because they're tailored to market specifically for families, as well as the price point may be slightly different overall on the ship. But in terms of scheduling by price point, that wouldn't be something that could feasibly be done because of the mix the lines themselves use. I mean, it's like any business, you're going to have individuals at varying income levels and price points supporting.
Just in terms of, I thought maybe encouraging them, because I know when passengers come, they actually get a per head, you know, amount. So if there's encouragement, that avenue.
At this stage, that's all equal. So there's no variation that, and there isn't any plans to vary cruise passenger tax.
And if you look at a cruise ship as well, a cruise ship is like a mini hotel,
yeah.
Right? So people that have the ocean front suites pay twice as much as the people down below with no view.
Yeah.
So So it's a difficult thing, and I know the chamber members who are in the cruise industry will tell you that, you know, looks can be very deceiving. And so somebody could walk in and cut out jeans and then and buy certain duty-free items that you wouldn't believe. So it's a difficult balance. Jude, you have a question?
First, just like to say just how very proud we are of the product that's offered from our tourism industry and all the amazing leaders in the audience and represented up here on the panel. Certainly you have my commitment, you have the full commitment of Kim and Finance to work and assist in any way that we can. The one thing that I will ask the panelists and also the audience is to help us break down the bureaucratic barriers that exist within our government. Anisha, you may recall 3 years ago, we actually sat and we attempted to have this process where we're meeting, talking about developing messaging of work in tourism, of good healthcare best practices. And at that time, a communique was sent from the Ministry of Financial Services instructing the Ministry of Tourism to cease those discussions. So maybe it's because I'm a bit older now, but I'm at a point now where we're going to disregard ignorant communication.
To do a video presentation, I think, I don't know if it's Cayman Finance, must be, that they're developing a presentation to share with visitors so they have an accurate presentation on what our financial services are about. I haven't followed up on it, but I know that the initiative is out there, and I think it's a step in the right direction.
Oh, that's excellent. Please put your hands up. Two questions. Three questions. No problem. You guys have stayed behind as long as you haven't been patient with me.
Quick question. Kabul is going to be taking place in middle of February, in the middle of our high season. I just wonder what thought and into the timing of that. And I know in the tourism development plan, they talk about having visitors come live with us and be with Cayman, I was a resident. I wonder whether you can put accommodation for those people. If you're going to bring in $14 million in revenue that is projected, where are you going to put those individuals who come in the middle of the day or the high season? And whether they're going to be local musicians as well involved in the lineup. And final question is, was CETA and other stakeholders consulted in the development of that festival, or was it a secret to be?
I'll let Pilar do the first part, CETA had nothing to do with the development of it. We were approached and informed that it was happening, we were given an opportunity to see how we could participate or create some synergies, and we're still working on that because it's happening. And you know, it's just another event with all the wonderful things to do here in the islands.
I think what's important is to re-bring diversity to the island. Again, I mean, we have the cookout event in January, now we got a, you know, that's their own food, and now what else can we do to get people to come back? Because, you know, you want to come back for some other new reason. And I think bringing music, entertainment in the next month, so we know that in the summer we try to bring the K-Film. If we can find a jazz festival, awareness, I mean, the more we're going to bring to the island, the better it is. It just brings the value to our destination.
What about the visitor experience of the product?
So I'm happy to take that question. As you know, DART is a major sponsor, so I'm happy to take the question on behalf of the Kabul organizers. If they were in the room, it would probably be better for them to answer, but to the extent that we came on board first, I'm happy to take it. So first off, yes, there will be local talent on the lineup. Kabul intends to have a very fair and democratic process, so they're going to do an open casting and a competitive process starting in June, I think, so that all local talent have the opportunity to earn a place on the billing. I can't tell you exactly what that looks like and how many, but I can get that answer for you and certainly make it available to the chamber to share. In terms of the timing, I had lots of discussion with the Kabul organizers about the time. You know, certainly that's a point in the tourism season when the island does really well. So will it drive incremental visitation in the first year? Not as much as it may 3 or 4 years from now when we have the new room stock on. But what it can do is create attention for Cayman at a time when people are thinking, our target market is thinking about a vacation. It will also generate incredible publicity. It's already generated incredible publicity for Cayman. The 14 million that was referred to in economic impact does not require the total number of attendees to come from off island. So it will be a combination of residents and visitors who are already planning to come to Cayman or planning to come in Cayman in February, and they just choose this weekend instead of another weekend because of the entertainment option. But I think the bigger point of Caboo is that for once, government has not had to put the $1, $2, or $3 million bill to organize an event. In my past life, we started JazzFest, we started Cookout, and those were all underwritten by government. Here's private sector taking a risk, and it is a risk, right? I mean, it's innovation, and you don't know how it's going to go with perfect certainty. But it's private sector taking a risk. It's partnerships with organizations like Virgin Produced. The founder, here's a coincidence, the founder of Caboo is himself a wealth manager, right? So he's a person who started out in financial services and has chosen to concentrate a fair amount of his wealth and his capital and that of his clients into the entertainment space. It's absolutely about innovation for them. A lot of technology goes into the differentiation of Caboo. So, you know, maybe for the tourism industry, we've been better at the end of April. Some of the reasons for February is it's outside of the US festival season. Caboo organizers feel that they can get access to talent at better prices if they're outside the US festival season, which starts in April. But I think we should all, as actually I heard one CIT member say, it's happening. Let's come together as a country and give it the best shot of being successful. It is private sector risk, and you know, we'll evaluate it after the first, second, third, and see how it goes. But certainly in the meantime, let's put the best Cayman foot forward and welcome those visitors, including the talent who's coming. And please don't miss that one of the comedians is a Bodden, I think his name is Alonzo Bodden, of Caymanian descent, who's on the US comedy circuit, has already been confirmed.
Dr. Hardy?
Thank you. Very interesting discussion panel, thank you. Will, you already mentioned the word carrying capacity. Teresa, you talked about better management. And Pilar, you talked about we're already there in terms of the resilience of some of our main attractions. The sandbar, as you know, is pretty much oversubscribed almost every day of the week, especially Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursdays. What plans are there in the natural tourism plan to limit access to the sandbar in particular, and how is that going to be managed? Because right now the visitor experience is definitely extremely poor there. My foundation has conducted the Stingray surveys for the last 16 years at the sandbar. It's the longest running study of a marine interactive program in the world, and we get an increasing amount of complaints about it. So how is it that the Port Authority, the Department of Environment, the Department of Tourism do not accept responsibility for management of our most attractive site?
Sure. I mean, we talk with a lot with our workforce partners in the CIT, which we're very familiar with the subject as well. The entity does talk about visitor management, and that is one of the zones. It's already a wildlife managed zone, but we feel it needs to be strengthened. And consultation has started somewhat on that. We don't have, I can't sit here and say we have an exact answer for you because there are a lot of people who are impacted by the activity at Stingray City, as well as the welfare of the environment is very important to us. It's our number one attraction, both cruise and stayover. So it's important for us to keep it safe and for the future of our islands. Some of the steps the government has taken is actually looking at multiple agencies that can come together to manage our marine environment. Stingray City would just be one of those environments that they manage. We have a number of ongoing water sports related issues due to the growth in tourism. And you know, it's one of those areas we haven't managed as proactively as we should. But I do know that there's steps in place. They're not, unfortunately, sitting here from a tourism perspective, It's not our role to do that, but it is our role to inform, and it is our role to say this is probably not the right way to do this, and we're doing that. And there are multiple agencies who are coming together and talking about how they can address that. So it's not going to be fixed today, but I know it is a part of the NTP, and there are multiple agencies already coming together to try to address that as one of the areas under water sports that needs attention.
We'll just have to maybe close on that because we're about out of time, but I would just give you two experiences I had. Well, most of you are international travelers. We live in Ohio. You have to get on a plane and go somewhere sometime. So I've been to a couple places too. One place I've gone to is Alaska, and I enjoy whale watching. And I know when you go to Alaska, they limit the number of boats that are ever allowed. And it's serious. They have Coast Guard people on board, and they monitor the captains right away. And I watched them turn boats away because they were getting too close to the whales. Then I had the pleasure of swimming with some special dolphins, apparently, in New Zealand. And again, monitored the number of interactions. We had a boat that was restricted in terms of numbers. I think it was 15 of us. And it was fascinating to watch in terms of how much pride they take in the environment and those precious creatures that bring in millions upon millions of dollars in money.
Well, before we wrap up, may I make one final comment?
Yep.
I think this has been a fantastic afternoon, and I'm not at all bothered by the fact that it's gone on a little bit late. I think we need to have more of these types of national conversations and conversations around sustainable development, which is what today felt like to me. So I wanted to say, first of all, thank you. And then I want to issue a challenge to all of us in the room to walk out of here today thinking of this as one Cayman. It's not sectors of Cayman, it's not whether you are a permanent resident or a permit holder or multi-generational Caymanian. As long as we're here on this tiny island, I mean, it's a small, small island. It is a fragile ecosystem. It is one Cayman. And so I would encourage us to just think about how do we make Cayman, this is my personal aspiration for the brand, how do we make Cayman by 2025 the best place in the world, first of all, to live. So it has to work for us. Those of us who are from here, those of us who live here. But to live, to work, to visit, to invest, to play, and to learn. If we can aim for all of us to work together to make Cayman, by 2025, the best place in the world to live, to work, to invest, to visit, to play, and to learn, we would have solved a lot of problems. And we can only do that if we come together. We have to avoid duplication. We have to put the ego aside. And we have to focus on making Cayman the best place in the world. So thank you, Chamber, for this opportunity.
Put your hands together for that. Thank you very much. I never had a question. I never had a question.
And I think there, you know, if you really want to grasp the nettles, then the thorny issues have to be addressed. Like, why is it, for example, that restaurant staff get paid a pittance, but the price, you nearly pay the same price here for a meal as you will in New York? Paul, you said earlier on that a lot of professions here, like whether it's a plumber, a waitress, whatever it is, it's kind of looked down upon. Sometimes it's because they're not treated fairly. They are worked to the bone in a lot of cases, and they're just struggling to survive. And really, these are the nettles that have to be grasped. And if it would be nice if all sectors pulled together. But it was interesting listening to Luke, because it's kind of like the public sector and the private sector, the finance sector in particular, they're like two alpha males. It struck me, particularly in that discussion, because you would think the natural thing would be to really work glove in hand together on that. But from a psychodynamic point of view, you know that there's a fear
on the government side that you're going to steal their thunder. I don't mean you personally, but the finance sector, because you're a huge engine, you're 50% of the country. But it goes back to what you said at the end, Pilar. If people don't get off their alpha purchase and actually work together and really buy into equity, equity for everybody, and as we used to say in Ireland, start getting rid of the brown paper bags. You know what that means, don't you? Right, my explain.
No, you don't have to explain it.
And be fair. I mean, be really fair.
Thank you.
Anyway, sorry.